Welcome back. So, as I suggested in my earlier video, we're going to learn about a software that can help us to develop these critical path diagrams and do the PERT CPM for us in a bit more automated way. So, there's a couple of options that we have. One is Microsoft Project, which of course is a paid software, so we'll require licenses for that. So we don't have access to Microsoft Project, and neither has the HEC provided us with access. So that's something that's out of the question. The other software that's possible to use is called Primavera. Again, it's a very expensive software, and we don't have licenses for that either, right? So what I suggest is that we use an open source project management software by the name of Project Libre, Libre. So if you open up your browser and you move to Project Libre on your Google search engine, you'll find that the very first link, which says sourceforge.net next to it, is going to pop up. So you'll click on this link and it will take you to the SourceForge website. And there's a big green button on your screen that says download on it. You'll click on that and about 60 something MB worth of download will take place on your computer, and you'll be able to then install the software. So in my case, when I did the download, it opened up a file, downloaded a file by the name of Project Libre-1.9.2.exe, and it's 63.7 MB. So wherever your downloads take place, it will get downloaded there. You can of course do this from home, and it will not cost any money. So please go ahead, go to Google, do a search for Project Libre, the very first link, click on it, come to the download page, press on the download button, download the software, double click on it, and it will install it on your computer, right? So it hardly takes a few minutes to install it. I've already installed the software on my computer, so I'll sort of just close this and restart it. There's two ways to restart it. One is to go into the start button. If you've got Windows 10 with the start button, you can do that. If you don't, then I don't know how to use Windows too well, so figure it out to find out where the applications are, but look for Project Libre. You can click from there and start it, or it will make sort of like a link on your main desktop. In my case, it has created a Project Libre link here, so I can double click on it and I can launch the software. Right. So once you click on the software, it opens up in somewhat of a half screen type of a format. There's a tip of the day that pops up. You can view the next step if you like, and the next step. You can keep this enabled if you like, or you can disable it so it doesn't show you the tips anymore. So for right now, we're not very much concerned about it. We'll just say close, and that will vanish. And now we've got two options in front of us. One is to create a project, and other is to open a project. The create the project button will help us to create a new project for us. And the open project button, you'll use that if you want to open up an existing project that you may have saved on your computer. So in our case, we don't have a project as yet. So let's just say create project. And now a new dialog box opens up and it asks us certain questions. So we need to fill in the relevant information here. So if you recall, I had suggested to you that all projects have names associated with them, right? You may call it the mega project or project X or whatever have you. So in this case, even though we're just going to practice an exercise, we still need some sort of a name to be given to this project. So let's give it the name exercise one, EX1, and we can decide to give it a project manager if we like. So I'll just give my own name here. You can leave this blank if you like. And by default, it picks today's date as the starting date, Or you can change this to some other data if you like, and any kind of notes that you want to put against this project, you can type them up here. So we'll sort of ignore it and we'll just accept the starting date as today's to be correct. And then we'll say, okay. And now I can extend the window a little bit and I'll pull this dialog box so it opens up so we can see all the resources and names and predecessors there, right? So this is a somewhat familiar interface because if you've used Microsoft Excel before, it has this familiar grid type of view going on here, right? So you've got rows and you've got columns, and each column has a name. Different types of names are there. The name of the activities come in this column. The duration of the activity comes in this column. If you don't want to put the duration, you can put the starting date and the finishing date, and it will automatically calculate the duration for you. Or you can just put the duration, and it will, because it has taken today's date as the starting date, so it will move the activities onto the Gantt chart appropriately and decide on the starting and finishing dates for it, right? Then we've got predecessors, right? It's a very simple idea. Predecessors are those things that come before a particular activity, right? So in our case, there may be certain activities which are the starting activities. So these are the very first activities that we're going to perform when we start the project, right? So those activities are not going to have any predecessors. But other activities that come after the starting activities, they will have predecessors, right? So predecessor basically means those activities that precede a particular activity, that come before a particular activity, right? So keep that in mind, that not all activities are going to have predecessors. Some activities will not have predecessors, and generally these are going to be activities that are placed on the diagram at the start of the project, right? So there's always certain activities that we perform that are signifying the starting of the project, and they don't have any predecessors. And then you can put the name of the resources. Now, what that implies is the people that are being held responsible for performing that particular activity. So for right now, we're going to ignore the resource column and we'll just sort of hide it so we don't get confused, right? Now, in the previous video, I showed you a diagram. So I'm just going to take the same diagram and I'll put the information here, right? So I had 6, 7, 8 activities, and their names were A, B, C, D, E, F, and G, and H, right? So I had 8 activities, and as soon as I start typing the names of these activities, here, certain serialization takes place on the left-hand side of your screen. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 are popping up in front of you, right? Now, the second concern that we have is the duration of these activities. So we already have the durations, and mind you, when I showed you the diagram in the previous video, it was the mirror image of it, so it may not have been completely understandable because the camera was taking it as a mirror image, but we'll sort of work with it, don't worry about it, right? So let's put the durations of it. So we'll come here, it says 1 day question mark. So by default, it's saying, okay, I think this is a 1 day long activity. So clearly this is not the case for us. We already know the durations of these activities, so let's put them here. Activity A is 5 days in length, so I'll just type 5, press enter or the down arrow key, and it will take me to the next activity. Activity B is 3 days in length, so I'll press enter here after I type 3. Activity C is 4 days in length, B is 5 days in length, E is 6 days in length, F is 7 days, G is 5 days, and H is 8 days in duration. So I have placed now the duration of these activities. And by default, what it is doing is that it's taking today's day, 8 a.m. in the morning, till 5 p.m. So it's a single shift consideration here, meaning that we can have three shifts in a day. We can have the morning shift, we can have the afternoon shift, and we can have the late night shift. That means in certain projects, you can have a 24-hour type of a workflow. In certain projects, you can have a 16-hour workflow. And in certain other projects, you can normally have an 8-hour workflow. So in this case, it's an 8-hour workflow, meaning a single shift is being run. So it takes it from 8 to 5 and takes into context this idea of lunch breaks and so forth. Right. So we'll just sort of leave the starting date here and we'll play with the predecessors. And this is how we're going to move the activities up and down and place them in the right place. Right. So now activity A is the starting activity. It does not have any predecessors. So we leave that this particular box in the first column for activity A. We leave that as the first row. We leave that as blank, right? Because A has no predecessor. It is the very first activity that we will perform. Now, activity B does have a predecessor. It requires that activity A comes to a conclusion. So if I try to put A here and press enter, it gives me this error message, which says that it is an invalid predecessor and use the task ID rather than the name of the activity, right? So that's going to give me an error message if I put A as the predecessor, but I do want A as the predecessor. So the way around this is that I put the number one, which is basically the number given, the task ID given to the very first column on which activity A exists in this particular grid design, right? So I'll put one here, which is this particular number. So if I put one here, it is saying that A is the predecessor for B. Now, activity C and D also have one as their predecessor, meaning that activity A is the predecessor for B, for C, and for D. So that's why I put the number one. Now, activity E has B as a predecessor. So you can guess that B has this task ID of 2. So if I want B to be the predecessor for E, so I need to put the number 2 here. Activity F has C as a predecessor, which has a task ID of 3. So I'll put that here. And activity G has D as a predecessor, and that has a task ID of 4, and I will put that here. And the last one, which is activity H, has 3 predecessors, which happen to be E, F, and G. So 5, 6, and 7, there are 3 predecessors here. So I'll put 5, semicolon, 6, semicolon, 7. You could also use commas and it will automatically convert this into semicolons, and that's not a problem. So I'll put it as 5, semicolon, 6, semicolon, 7, and then press enter. Right? So notice what happens with the starting date and ending dates. These all have changed based upon this idea of the predecessors that we have entered into the grid pattern. Right now, I can shrink this a little bit. And let's look at this diagram that we have with these red and blue bars that are popping up here. Right? So notice what's going on at the very top of this diagram figure here is that we've got the 14th of July week. We've got the week of the 21st of July, the week of the 28th of July, and so on and so forth. Right? Now, activity A is 5 days in length. It begins on the 16th and it finishes on the 22nd, right? So this is the 22nd right here. The ending of this red bar is the 22nd and the starting of the red bar is the 16th. And then there's activity B, C, and D, E, F, G, and H. And when does this project come to a conclusion? it comes to a conclusion here on the 17th of July 2020 as its ending date. So it will begin here on the 16th of June and it will end here on the 17th of July, right? Now, something else is going on here as well, which is you see these S's here on the top here. This is your days of the week. So you've got Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, which are working days. So that's why you see this particular area here to be white in color. And Saturday and Sunday are grayed out. So by default, the software is thinking that Saturday and Sunday are off days for you and Monday through Friday are working days for you. So not only is it taking 5 days here as the duration of A, it is adding 2 days to it, which are non-working days, right? So basically starting from Tuesday and finishing here on at the end of Monday also includes Saturday, Sunday as off days. So this view is called the Gantt chart, right? The Gantt chart shows you basically your activities placed on top of a calendar, and it is not showing you the working days, it is showing you the calendar days, right? So the calendar time of this project is longer than the working time. How much longer is it? So we've got a weekend here, 1 weekend here, and 1 weekend here. So I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 days extra added into the total duration of the project as off days, right? So the duration of the project, as I mentioned in the previous video, was 24. So that 24 is basically the working days, and this 24 plus these weekends, right? The additional 8 days added to 24 signifies the calendar days here, right? So it is a bit longer on the calendar and it is much more shorter as far as the working days are concerned, right? So this is what the Gantt chart looks like. Now, also notice that the bars have different colors. Certain bars are blued and certain bars are left in red color. So what does that mean? It means that these bars are basically a part of your critical path, right? And the blued out bars are not on the critical path. So in a way, it's doing two things. One, it's showing you your project on a calendar, right? Plus, it is showing you basically the critical path activities, which are red in color, right? So from this, we can understand that A is a critical path activity. I can look at this one. So this is C, which is a critical path activity. F is also a critical path activity. And H is also a critical path activity. Now I can move here to this tab, which says tasks, and I can click on the task, and then I can click on the network diagram. So this suddenly changes, and now we start seeing this as a in a different view. So I'll move these boxes a little bit up so it starts resembling the diagram that I showed to you on that piece of paper in the previous video, right? And amazingly, it just looks exactly like that diagram, right? We have an activity A which has no predecessor. So activity A begins on this 16th. By default, it runs for 5 days. It comes to a conclusion. The output of A becomes the input for B. The output of A becomes the input for C, and the output of A becomes an input for D. So B, C, and D will only begin after 5 days have elapsed. That is, activity A has run for 5 days. Then B is going to take its time, which is 3 days. C is going to run for 4 days. D is going to run for 5 days. The output of B is going to become the input for E, the output for C will become the input for F, the output of D will become the input for G, and the output of E, F, and G all together become the input for H, and then H will run and it will come to a conclusion. And the middle path, you see, A, C, F, and H are all red in color, right? So that means that A, C, F, H are the critical path activity, A, B, E and H at the top is a non-critical path. A, D, G and H is also a non-critical path, right? So we're concerned about the middle path here. Now we want to make sure that these are not delayed by any amount of time, right? So if we add this, right, 5 plus 4 is 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 16, 16 plus 8, 24. So this path, when added up together, the 5 plus the 4 plus the 7 plus the 8 is 24 days in length. So this project is going to run for 24 working days, right? Calendar days wise, it's a bit longer. It's 24 plus the 8 days for the 4 weekends that we saw on the Gantt chart, right? So this gives us the particular diagram here, and we can see how it looks like, right? Now I can go back to my Gantt button, and it takes me back to my Gantt chart. I can click on the network diagram, and it can take me back to my network view, right? So this looks this network diagram looks a little bit different than the diagram that I had on that piece of paper, because these are two different methods that are possibly used. The problem is that the method that I did on the piece of paper is something that the softwares don't follow. The softwares follow a newer method, and what you're seeing here in front of you is that new method, which is called the activity on nodes or the precedence diagramming method, right? So the ADM the PDM, the precedence diagramming method, or the activity on nodes diagramming method is what you're sort of seeing on your screen. It's an amended version of the full method. It's not the complete method, but it gives us a very good idea of what's going on, right? Now I can go back to my project here, and I can click on projects, right? And it gives me some additional information. So it gives me this information that the name of the project, which I give it as EX1, exercise one, the starting date by default it picked up as today, the finishing date it calculated as 17th of July. I typed in the name of my own name as the manager, and the status date, etc., the cost, the number of work hours, etc., are all sort of placed here, right? So we'll sort of ignore that for right now. I can go back to my Gantt chart here. Then I can go back to file, and I can click on the information button, and it will start giving me some more information. So let's have a look what it tells me here. Does it tell me anything different? So it says the name of the manager, name of the project, starting date, the status, the calendar type, right? It's a standard calendar. It's in the planning process. No expenses have been sort of incurred so far, right? I can click on the statistics, and it gives me additional information. And this is what I'm looking for, right here. Look, duration 24. So how long is the project? It is 24 days in length. So is it 24 calendar days or is it 24 working days? So just be clear that this is 24 calendar days. Don't worry about all the remaining information here about the cost and other things. So we were not yet concerned about these for the moment, right? And we didn't put any notes there, so no information pops up there, right? So again, by clicking on information, going to statistics, you can find out the duration of your project. So this is a brief overview of how this runs. I'll type up a couple of more exercises for you, and your task this week is to download the software and then retry this exercise yourself, play around with the software and try to become a little bit more familiar with it. And then also try the additional exercises that I'm going to provide to you, put them into the software and try to figure out their outcomes, right? The durations of those. And you can take screenshots of these, and I'll create an assignment in our Google Classroom, and you can upload your screenshots as your assignment outcomes so that I can grade you, and we can move forward, right? So thank you very much.